Welcome, everybody. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone.
Today, I will be taught the word of God. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I am ready to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone.
Winning zone.
Father, we magnify you. We give you all the glory. And Father, you are the first, last, beginning, and the end. Hallelujah. Come on. Huh.
From a generation to another,
we declare
the famous name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Celebrate his resurrection power.
Come on, say
life so we can live in freedom,
freedom. In every nation.
In every nation.
He is alive.
He is alive.
Come on.
In every language it's the same.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Put your hands in the head of name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let me know.
Jesus is alive.
Come on, come on, sing.
From one generation to another,
we declare
the famous name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Celebrate his resurrection power.
Come on, sing.
Give his life so we can live in freedom, freedom.
In every nation.
In every nation.
He is alive.
He is alive.
In every nation. We are going to say,
he conquered death.
So I can live.
So I can live.
He paid my debt.
He paid my debt.
Now I'm free.
Now I'm free.
He conquered death.
He conquered death.
So I can live.
So I can live.
He paid my debt.
He paid my debt.
Now I'm free.
Now I'm free.
He conquered death.
He conquered death.
So I can live.
So I can live.
He paid my debt.
He paid my debt.
Now I'm.
Now I'm free.
He conquered death.
He conquered death.
So I can live.
So I can live.
Every language.
In every language it's the same.
world, over the world, over the world, over the world, over the world. Come on, come on.
Oh, jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. Oh, he is. Jealous for me. His love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, 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 how he loves us. How he loves us. Oh.
Sing, oh, 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 heaven.
the snoopy wickets in my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have the time to make crazy for rest when a nigga goes the way he loves me.
He loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
He loves me.
He loves us. Oh,
he loves me.
He loves us.
Oh, good God,
oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Welcome to Summit Church Online. We are glad that you're here. We've got a powerful experience for you today.
Yes.
Hey, honey, I noticed we've got a lot of people that are watching us all over the world. We've got people, let me see, London, I noticed, Nigeria, Lagos, Nigeria, Chicagoland area. Several people watch us from Chicago. Shout out to Chicago, shout out to London, wherever you are. I'm leaving a whole bunch of places out.
Thank you,
but
yes, wherever you are.
It's a blessing to have technology that we're able to reach people all over, just to be able to spread the gospel and tell people about God's grace, his unmerited favor, about his love. You know, our message is basically this: God is not mad at you. He's madly in love with you. And no matter what it looks like in your life right now, you may be going through a hard time or you may be in a difficult spot, I want you to know that God loves you. Even though it may not look like he does, he loves you. And he wants to help you, all right? And so stay tuned, because no matter what you're dealing with right now in your life, you're about to get inspired, encouraged, and uplifted as you hear about the goodness of God, all right? So we're going to take you right into today's experience.
Woo!
it happens now, man. I'll tell you what. Have you been blessed today? Praise God. Have you been blessed by the worship? Let's just jump right into talking about rest. How to enter God's rest. Man, I tell you, it is so much into this, and we'll dive right in. We started this series last week, and we started off talking about how, after God created the world, he rested. Man, I tell you what, and what that means is he completed it. Rest means complete, okay? God has not, I mean, it's almost impossible to overstate this. And see, you can understand, see, we have a risen Savior. He has risen. Death could not hold him. We serve a risen Savior. And when you understand rest, see, or to understand rest, you need to understand the finished work of Jesus. And I've shared this before, and this is very important to your understanding of the Bible. I'm rewriting the book, my basic training. We pulled that book, and so we're taking the law out of it, and I've added some things on there that will help you in your Bible interpretation, and that's almost done. I got a couple little pieces to go, and then we're going to roll that back out. Basic training, praise the Lord. But in interpreting the Bible, how do you read the Bible? You should read the Bible in the light of the finished work of Jesus. Because everything in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is about Jesus. And see, understanding that, you'll understand what God did when he created the earth, the heavens and the earth, and after the sixth day, or on the seventh day, after 6 days of creation, he rested. That doesn't mean he was exhausted. After putting up that tree, man, it was work getting them trees up and all the other stuff of creation. Man, I'm tired. So God was just exhausted, and he just like fell out. Y'all don't bother me today. He put a sign up, do not disturb, over his door. Told the angels, look, don't bother me today. I'm resting. Okay? After I go home and eat, I typically go on the couch and lay out. I rest. But that's not what God did. God, it was completed. I gave you the example about an artist. Once he paints a beautiful portrait, and one more stroke would mess it up. One more stroke of the brush would mess it up. So he rests. That means it's complete. There's nothing else for me to do. See, you can't overstate this, really, because this is very important. When God finished creation, nothing has been created ever since. And when people talk about man created this, man created that, man hadn't created anything. Only thing man has done is discovered stuff that God already put in creation. Siri told me this morning there's 7.28 billion people on the earth. I asked Siri on the way to church, how many people on the earth? Siri said, 7.28 billion people. God provided oxygen in creation. Enough oxygen, not just for Adam and Eve, but for 7.28 billion people and however many other billion people come on the earth. There was enough oxygen in creation for everybody. For everybody today. Isn't that something? And see, man, all this ties into the New Testament talks about this. He compares the rest that we're to enter into in the new covenant as believers to the rest of God when he finished creating the heavens and the earth. Man, I tell you. Man, this is so good. Y'all just looking at me, because I know where I'm going. Y'all don't. But this is so awesome. And I also mentioned last week that man was the whole reason for creation. He was the crown. You and I, we are the crown of God's creation. God didn't create man last because we were less important. It was because we were more important. Think about it. If God had created man on the first day, he would have had to tread water for 3 days before God gave him some ground. But God, listen, he created man on the sixth day, and after everything was created, and everything was complete. And when God looked over everything that he made, he said it was good. That's an understatement. It was perfect. I can imagine God's like, man, this is awesome. If you think about that, man, I got stuck on this last week, man. But I tell you, nothing had to be created since. Electricity wasn't, man didn't create that. It was discovered. That was in creation. All the oxygen that the world would ever need was created. See, that's a picture of the rest that we're to enter into today. Because Adam, everything was provided for him. All he had to do was reach out and receive it. All he had to do is go out there and partake of everything that God had made. Hebrews chapter 3. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit, verse 7, as the Holy Spirit says today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me and tried me and saw my works 40 years. Now I'm going to mention a couple of verses, 8 and 9, from the Mirror translation, or the Mirror Bible, rather. More of a paraphrase, it's a paraphrase, not a translation, excuse me, but I can get stuck here, but I'm just going to read it. And just for those of you that weren't here or didn't hear the message last week, check this out. Therefore, do not be calloused in heart as the people of Israel were every time. Now, this has to do with, no, I'm not ready for that. You can, all right, yeah, just stay right there. This is in reference to the children of Israel in the wilderness and how they were in the wilderness for 40 years. God told them the land was theirs, but they were stuck there because of their unbelief. God had given them the land and they needed to go in and possess it, but they didn't. And their unbelief kept them out. That's very important. Now, this is an example for us, so we don't act like them and get into unbelief. He said, do not be calloused in heart as the people of Israel were every time they faced any contradiction or temptation in the wilderness. Their response immediately revealed their irritation rather than their faith. Your fathers continue to scrutinize me suspiciously, examining me as though my intentions with them could not be trusted, even though they were eyewitnesses of my miraculous works for 40 years. Wow. And what happened was, see, their circumstances contradicted what God said about them, and they compared themselves to their circumstances rather than comparing themselves to what God said about them. And so they faced these contradictions. What they saw, those giants, were a contradiction to what God said. And they compared themselves to the circumstances, and so they were irritated. Their response of unbelief, it revealed their irritation. Let's look at verse 10. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart. Say, God was angry. Say it. Say, God was angry. And I said last week, I believe this, that The biggest sin is unbelief. And I'm going to give you some scripture that I believe supports that. See, because unbelief, it just totally stops God in his tracks. You can't even get out of the mess you're in unbelief. If you're in sin, if you're in fornication or other kind of stuff, I just don't want to hobby horse that. There's other kinds of sins, but that just came to my mind. But you got to trust God to get out of it. So that's the reason that, I mean, that sin is bigger than fornication. So they always go astray in their hearts, and they have not known my ways, so I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Because Israel did other stuff. They had other sins going on. But the sin that God brought out was that sin of unbelief. Because when you're in mess and when you're in trouble, you can't get out with unbelief. You get out by trusting God. He said, they shall not enter my rest. Verse 11, beware, brethren, say beware, lest there be in any of you. See, he's talking to us today. Beware lest there be in any of you an evil heart. You see what God calls unbelief? Evil. This is not no light thing. Lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. Wow. In departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. What sin is he talking about? Unbelief. Now, you know, last time I spent some time talking about how much you need to remind yourself about who you are. I encourage you to remind yourself daily. Look, I'm approved. I'm accepted. I'm highly favored. I'm loved. God loves me. I'm qualified. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. You have to keep reminding yourself of that because the devil keeps coming at you with the same stuff. How long do I need to remind myself? As long as the devil keeps coming against you, telling you you should be a better mom. You should keep your house up better. See, he's the accuser of the brethren. Isn't he always coming against your mind, telling you stuff? When does he stop? He will never stop. Oh, you should lose weight. Look at you. You don't look like Miss Carla. Look how she looks. She works herself out. So all of a sudden, then you get into, oh man, you know, feeling bad about yourself. So that's why you have to keep reminding yourself, no, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. I don't care how much I weigh. Right now, however many pounds I weigh, however much overweight I am, I'm approved. See, you don't concern yourself trying to look like somebody else, man. You frustrate yourself trying to look as good as me. You never will achieve that. So just be satisfied with who you are and know who you are and tell yourself that I'm loved and I'm accepted, that God loves me. I'm just, you know, giving you some humor. You know, that's not true, but I think I'm the best looking person on the face of the earth because I just love me some me. I just do. I'm not conceited. I just know who I am. I'm not trying to look like somebody else. God loves you. Amen. That's the way you need to see yourself. You're approved. You're accepted. God don't make any junk. You're the only one on the face of the earth like you. Nobody has your fingerprint. I pull out my phone. I got a fingerprint thing on my phone, a button where I can put my fingerprint in there. You can't open my phone up. You cannot unlock my phone with your fingerprint. I don't care how much you try.
You can try all day. Because you ain't like me, man. And I ain't like you. Now you're going to love this. Woo, man, this is from the mirror again. Look at verse 13. Instead of what the stuff he said before about unbelief, deceitfulness of sin, evil heart of unbelief, instead, remind one another, not just yourself, remind other folks. What? Daily. How often? Daily. Of what? Your true identity. Who I am in Christ. What God, going back to Hebrews 1, what God is speaking through the Son. God in time past spoke by to the fathers by the prophets. In these last days, how is he speaking? Through the Son. What's the Son saying? You accepted, you approved, you qualified, you righteous, you redeemed, you anointed, you blessed. You know why? Because it's finished. It's already done. Your prosperity is already done. Your healing is already done. Like Gloria will say, all righty then. Gloria in our Fort Wayne campus, man, she's like, all righty then. That's right, all righty then. Praise God. Man, well, see, when you understand this, it was, this is in light of the finished work. And you're going to see, he compares it to how God finished creation. It was done. When Jesus said it is finished, your healing was done. Your marriage was successful. You were healed by his stripes. Glory to God, man. Man, that make you want to do the spanky leg, man. Hang on, I'm falling. All right. Remind yourself daily. Man, it's a big party, man. On God's great dance floor, baby. It's a party. See, man, none of that stuff, man. When you understand, it's the biggest party. Man, the church got the biggest party. What are you talking about, man? Man, forget it. It's finished. Forget it. It's a finished work. I'm not trying to get healed. I'm already healed. I've already been blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. Ephesians 1:3, 2 Peter 1 tells us that we've been given exceeding great and precious promises. 2 Corinthians 1:20 says all of God's promises are yes. It's already done. You got victory now. It's just resting in the finished work. When your husband rises up, he starts all this fussing and arguing. He says, thank you, Lord. I just thank you, Lord. It's finished. Oh, Lord, I thank you. My marriage is blessed. Just turn over and go to sleep. Hallelujah. It's finished, man. Glory to God. Oh, Zach just texted me and said it's the stanky leg. Not the spanky leg. Okay. Whatever it is. What I call it, the spanky leg. I'm gonna do the spanky leg, man. I do me the spanky leg. Whatever I do, I be dancing the way I want to dance. I call it what I want to call it. I'm partying like I want to party. Huh? Amen. I think I'm glad that you listened to this message, Zachary. Exactly right. All right. So remind yourself. I just pray that that's not the only thing you get out of this message today. Pastor said it. See, somebody didn't even know I messed that up until I said, somebody. I said, somebody. I didn't know. I messed it up. Okay, so remind one another daily of your true identity. You think you don't need to remind yourself? God says, remind yourself daily. Aren't you glad we can have fun? Have fun at church. Make today count. How you make today count? Reminding yourself. Did I tell you? You're approved. You're righteous. You're accepted. You're highly favored. You're deeply loved. You're greatly blessed. You're qualified. Remind yourself. Make the day count. Do not allow callousness of heart to cheat you, to cheat any of you, for even a single day out of your allotted portion. Today I'm righteous, accepted, and approved. Tomorrow I'm righteous, accepted, and approved. When you get tired of hearing me say that, it's time for you another church, because it's I'm going to keep saying it. And you can go to places that they, if you want to get beat down and and tell you what you need to do to get God to accept you, there's a whole lot of churches that will tell you that every single week. They will remind you of that. See, some of you make this mistake of thinking, I already know that. You know what remind means? This is God saying this. I'm not making this up. Somebody on a job come and get in your face, start cussing you out. You need to remind yourself. Because everybody don't act lovely. And that's when you need to know, when somebody tell you, you ain't nobody, you ain't nothing, you ain't never going to be anything, you'll never amount to anything. You're like, I'm righteous, I'm accepted, I'm approved. Man, you need to get this into your children, because you got teachers that will try to label kids and tell them you're dumb and you're slow. No, I'm the righteousness of God. You need to put that in on the inside of them. So they're armed. And then there's these kids at school that they're always going to tell you about your faults. Kids are faced with a lot of stuff, man. Young girls, man, I could, man, spend the rest of my time talking about this, how they, a lot of teenagers concerned about how, all about how they look. You think I look good? What you think about these shoes? You like this blouse? You like my top? You like my dress? You like my pants? Man, I wouldn't wear them. Look at her, you know. You got other girls at school looking at, man, what's she got on, man? Why is she wearing that? Why is she wearing that same thing all the time? Why are you? So you've got to tell your children who they are. You got to remind them that they're loved. You got to tell them that God loves them. You got to tell them you love them. That they're approved and accepted, all right? So verse 14, for we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, for who having heard rebel? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Next verse. Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? Next verse. And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see, verse 19, why couldn't they enter into the promised land that God had for them? Because they could not enter in because of unbelief. Say unbelief. Look at verse 19. Boy, I tell you, you got your shouting clothes on? Watch this. The mirror. The point is this. Even though... Now, see, they saw, maybe I didn't put this in here, but you just listen to this. Now, remember, they saw his works for 40 years in the wilderness. Okay. I mean, you know, God did some miracles for them in the wilderness. But the point is this. Even though they survived by supernatural means in the wilderness for 40 years, listen, you can survive but not live in the fullness of what God has for you. You can. There's two ways to live, either by God's grace or by your self-effort, and you can try to live by your self-effort and you can survive. And thinking that you're walking in the blessings of God when actually you're walking in your own self-effort and in your own works. And you can be walking in a merit-based system. And when we deal with rest, don't even stress trying to rest. Well, am I rest? Just hang on with me. Don't stress about anything, not even being in rest. And okay. Even though, listen real good now, even though they survived by supernatural means in the wilderness for 40 years, they failed to grasp what God had in mind for them. Their own unbelief disqualified them. Now, the commentary in the Message Bible says this: you can experience God's supernatural provision and protection and yet remain outside his rest. The ultimate proof of faith is not experience of the supernatural, but entering into his rest. See, God can do some supernatural stuff in his love and mercy for you to get you out. But this says that you can experience his supernatural provision and protection, but still be outside his rest. And the ultimate proof of faith is not experience of the supernatural, but entering into his rest. His rest celebrates his perfect work. He longs for you to discover your own completeness and perfection as seen from his point of view. Oh, man. His rest is sustained. Say sustained. His rest is sustained in you by what he sees, knows, and says about you in reference to the finished work of Christ. Jesus is what God believes about you. Oh, man. I can do the spanky leg now. His rest. It's sustained. How's it sustained? In us. By what God sees, knows, and says about you. In reference to the finished work of Christ. What does he see and say? I'm glad you asked. You're approved. You're righteous. You're accepted. See, when you know that, his rest is sustained in you. By what he knows about you. But do you know it? And when you know it and trust in it, that's when you rest. When you're going through a financial difficulty, ask yourself, what does God say about this situation? He supplies all my need. I'm resting. And the rest is sustained by, it's sustained. It's sustained by what he knows about me. Oh, if you just know about yourself what he knows about you. Ah. What do you know? That's why I can't. Man, you should go and work doing that spanky leg, man, because when somebody asks you, how's it going or what's going on, you're like, nothing. Are you kidding me? What's going on, man? I'm floating in the work. I'm in the rest, man. I because God's work it's complete. And this is why I say that the Lord gave me a scripture for this to support what I said about in my belief that unbelief is the biggest sin. When Jesus was in his own hometown in Mark 6, watch this. Jesus left that part of the country and returned with his disciples to Nazareth, his hometown. Next verse. The next Sabbath, he began teaching in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. They asked, where did he get all this wisdom and the power to perform such miracles? See, they saw him grew up, man, he's a carpenter. Yeah, I know. That boy made them, that cabinet is in my house. See, and they brought him down to a common level. And they scoffed at him. Now they were amazed. You can be amazed by what you see Jesus do, but be in unbelief. He's just a carpenter. The son of Mary and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon, and his sister. There's his sister right there. You know, their brother go over there. They were offended, and his sisters live right here among us, and they were deeply offended and refused to believe in it. They refused to believe in it. Then Jesus told them, a prophet is not honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his relatives and his own family. And because of their unbelief, he couldn't do any miracles. And here's what the Lord shared with me about this. There's not one place where God refused to heal somebody because of how they were living. The only thing that ever stopped Jesus from doing miracles was unbelief. That's how. Unbelief, it's so important that you know that that'll shut you out of the blessings of God because of their unbelief. Now, in reference to what we're talking about, what do we believe? We believe in the finished work of Jesus, that your victory is already complete. See, because of their unbelief, he couldn't. It didn't say he wouldn't. Wow. I said, wow. It didn't say he wouldn't. Like, wouldn't means, all right, I'm a carpenter, all right, I'm out of here. I ain't doing nothing for y'all. I can do it, but I ain't. I ain't doing nothing. No, it didn't say he ain't. Said he couldn't. Unbelief will stop God from moving in your life. He couldn't. You don't think God will change your family situation? And then he can't. You don't believe he can? You don't believe he can fix your finances? He can't. You don't really believe he'll heal you? Then he can't. Unbelief will stop him. You believe you always have lack? You will. Well, it's hard. Hard to prosper when you're doing it on your own. But when you see yourself already prosperous, you rest. So he couldn't do any miracles among them, except to place his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed. He was amazed at their unbelief. Then Jesus went from village to village teaching the people. See, that's a cure for unbelief, teaching and getting the word into people. Are you listening to me? He went about teaching. Let's go into chapter 4. The New Testament wasn't written in chapter and verses. It was just one continuous narrative. He's still talking about the same thing. It says, therefore, going into chapter 4, since a promise remains of entering his rest. What rest is he talking about? The rest that Jesus has provided for us. He said, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. Wow. The gospel is good news. The gospel is a good news of God's grace. Do you know the Israel that came out of Egypt through Moses had the gospel preached to them? They lived under grace until they got to the point where they said, Lord, give us what they had an arrogant attitude. They said, Lord, tell us what to do and we'll do it. That's when everything changed. Up to that point, that's when Moses went up on Mount Sinai and got the law. But prior to that, God dealt with them according to grace. Even Cain, when he murdered his brother, God put a mark on him that nobody would touch him, even though he had did wrong. Sin is not imputed where there's no law. So God dealt with him. There was no law for Cain. And so God dealt with him according to his grace and his mercy. From Adam until Moses, God dealt with people according to his unmerited favor. Here it says, the gospel was preached to them. They thought they could live up to God's standards. Lord, tell us what to do. We big and bad. We can do it. And then God gave them the law. And God's whole attitude toward them changed. Up till then, he wasn't pointing out their faults. Oh, you can do this. You can measure up to my standard? Okay. And he gave them the law. Not to make us righteous. The Bible tells us the law was not made for a righteous man. The purpose of the law was to bring man to the end of himself, to bring man to his knees and say, "Lo, you can't on your own come up to my standard." The law was given to bring man to the end of himself. Isn't that amazing? He said the gospel was preached to them as well as to us. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. See? They couldn't enter the rest because of their unbelief. They didn't mix the word with faith. God told them to go take the land, but they didn't do it. And so, for we who have believed do enter that rest as he has said. So I swore in my wrath they shall not enter my rest, though the works were finished from the foundation of the world. You see how he compares that rest with God's finished work in creation? He said the works were finished from the foundation of the world. All right, it's giving time. We want to give you an opportunity to give if you would like to give. Your financial support helps us to do what God has called us to do, to fulfill the vision that God has given us here. We've got a vision here at Summit Church, which includes reaching you through church online, and we want to be able to spread this word to other people. And please tell other people about us. Tell other people, tell your friends, your family, your loved ones
how they can dial into church online so we can help more people, all right? And give more people this gospel of the grace of God. Amen. So if you would like to give, there's a give button in the upper right-hand corner of your screen. Click that give button and follow the steps, and you can give securely. And we appreciate your financial support, and we'll see you again in Church Online.
Have a great week.